Brother Burl if he would come and introduce Nancy a little bit and share a little bit about his connection with the ministry there. And he's made several trips down there, so we'll look forward to hearing that. And Brother Burl just got back on Wednesday from Romania. So just a quick update on that, and then maybe next Sunday we'll hear some more. He said no.
I'll be with her next Sunday.
Do what? Oh, you'll be with her next Sunday. Yeah, that's right. That's right. Well, we'll get an update on that in the future. Later. So, come on up here, Brother Burl, and share a little bit about whatever the Lord put on your heart. Be fine. And then have Nancy come and share with
us. Okie dokie. One fateful day, a fellow that has a car lot in Graham wandered into my store, said, I need to put some tires on a car. I'm going to loan it to a missionary.
Oh, okay.
Where's she from? Or where's the missionary from? I didn't know it was a she or he. Guatemala. I said, cool. I'd like to meet her. Okay. I bet we can make that happen. So time elapsed. She took the car and went where she was going to go and all, and the day came, and they said, well, why don't you come to church over here where she's going to be speaking today? I said, I can't. We've got to do something in our church. I don't remember what it was, but I had to do something here. He said, well, meet us for lunch. Okay, I can do that. So we end up at the lunch place, and they just sit me down next turn and say, well, you know, get to know her. I said, okay, good. I said, where did you go? Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da in Georgia. I said, oh, where'd you go in Georgia? And she named a couple towns, and I said, oh, well, I thought maybe you'd gone through Dublin, Georgia. She says, who do you know in Dublin? I said, there's a guy that I knew from school named Randall Gerhardt. He pastors a church in Dublin. And she says, Randy was my pastor for 14 years in Michigan. I said, oh, you're from, and I named the name of the church in Port Huron. She says, exactly. And that started a little bit of common ground stuff. And soon after that, I ended up going, and then we've had other people go from this area. Haley Carter, she called me up one time and said, if I wanted to go on a mission trip, how could I do that? I said, call this lady. And then she took Shawnee, and Shawnee took James, and so forth, and so forth, and so forth, and so forth, and so forth. And it's a good thing. Nancy's got an excellent testimony, and she might as well just go ahead and tell us whatever you want, because did I do okay? Okay, good. All right. Come on. Everybody give her a good hand clap.
Good morning.
Howdy, howdy.
Well, I just flew in from California yesterday, so I'm still getting settled, but looking forward to some time here in Texas. I know quite a few people from the area, and Burl has me pretty busy for the time frame that I'm going to be here. Tomorrow morning, I'm going to be actually on a radio morning show for a station out of Graham. I'm going to be at the Graham Theater tomorrow night for a meet and greet to be able to, you know, catch some people that I won't be seeing at churches. Tuesday through Friday, I'm going to go drive up to Fayetteville and see someone that I know there. And then I'll come back and have two more churches next weekend to be able to do here in this area. And then on Tuesday, I fly to Atlanta area to be able to be there for a while, to be able to do some churches in the Georgia area. How old is Seth?
11.
11, okay. A little bit older. This all started for me when my son came home and said that he wanted to go on a mission trip with our church youth. And I thought, okay, that's good. I was raising my children alone. My husband left me when my children were babies. And so I was raising my children alone, and I told my son that would be wonderful. And the long and short of it is I offered, my daughter wanted to go along too, and she wasn't old enough, so I offered to go along as a chaperone, and We were allowed to go together as a family. We went on a 10-day mission trip to Jamaica. It was my first face-to-face with true poverty. And that trip forever changed my life. I came back and it just didn't leave my heart. Within 6 months' time, I was packed up lock, stock, and barrel with my two children, driving a four-wheel drive Jeep with a horse trailer behind it with all of our belongings and two family dogs driving to Guatemala, driving from Michigan. My son being 15 and my only relief driver. That's scary. But we made it. We gave a one-year commitment. That was back in 1989. So obviously things have changed and God just put it in my heart to be able to stay there. That's home for me now. God has done some amazing, amazing, amazing things in my life. I do have a couple more copies of my book back there. I was very limited on what I could carry with me because I'm going from flight to flight, you know, but I do have a couple more copies back there and I could mail some copies of books to people. But it tells of some of my stories, some of the things that have happened over the years, including being in jail a couple of times and being a fugitive and being accused of murder. Yeah, I've had a few incidents, adventures in my life. But God has been faithful through it all. And like I say, He has done some amazing things. I liked that little teaching about the boldness and being firm. And one of the chapters in my book is called Sister Nancy is Like a Dog. And I thought, okay, I had some local missionaries that invited me over to their house. And I was supposed to meet with some people and they were from the mountains. And these mountain people were not educated. And sometimes you have to say things in a way that they would understand. And I say that with all love and respect in my heart because this is who God has called me to be able to lay down my life for, is some very humble mountain people that God loves and that I love. And so they were introducing me and they said, Sister Nancy is like a dog. And I thought, okay, I don't think I've ever been introduced this way before. And then he said, Sister Nancy is like a dog with a bone in her mouth. And I thought, okay, we're getting better. and he said, Sister Nancy is like a dog with a bone in her mouth, and she's not going to let go of it for nothing.
Amen.
And they were trying to get across the concept of tenacity, mm-hmm. of perseverance.
Right.
And I believe that if I have anything to offer the kingdom of God, if I have anything, I believe one of my greatest assets that I have to be able to offer God is that I'm not going to quit.
Amen.
I'm not going to quit. You know, I don't feel like I'm a great preacher. I don't have a bunch of letters after my name. I don't feel like I'm a great singer. I don't know how to play the piano. You know, there's a lot of things I could say I don't think that I'm good at or I don't know how to do. But I'll tell you one thing. If I think that God has told me to do something, I'm not going to back off of that until He says it's over. There was a time that the law was, I was under investigation legally for a terrible, heinous crime that was done against a little girl. And my lawyer called me and said, Nancy, I think a warrant for your arrest is coming out today. And I was on my way to the airport to be able to come back to the United States. And I flew into Dallas. And I was looking over my shoulder the whole way, you know, wondering, was someone coming to get me? Or when I got off the plane in Dallas, was someone waiting for me, you know, to be able to take me? And my daughter called me and she says, Mom, are you going back? Are you going back to Guatemala? And I said, yes, Julie. And she said, Mom, if you know that there's a warrant out for your arrest, are you going back to Guatemala? And I said, Julie, unless God tells me not to, yes. Because this is what God's called me to. I know, God knows the truth. And I'm going to continue to do what He's asked me to do. And that attitude has taken me so far, so far. And like I say, I just, you know, wanna, you know, your teaching, you know, touch me, because that's what life is all about. You know, has anyone seen the movie, the new movie that's out, Paul the Apostle? Has it come to this area? I highly suggest that if it comes here, go see it. I haven't been to a movie theater in probably 5 years, and on this trip I saw, I can only imagine twice, I saw Paul twice, and I saw the new God's Not Dead three times. Yeah, Spanish, English Nancy today. I saw that one twice. Paul the Apostle is a tremendous movie. A lot of times movies are done from the perspective of Jesus. You know, the Jesus film, Campus Crusade, The Passion of Christ. It's done from the perspective of Jesus. And yes, we should never, never, never forget what he did for us. But there's a part of our humanness that sometimes separates and says, well, that's Jesus. But the movie of Paul is centered on the church. It's centered on the first generation church. And it centers on what was that church willing to do in the face of persecution? What price were they willing to pay? How far were they willing to go? And I'll tell you, it impacts you. I sat through that two different times. I went with my board because we got together from our annual meeting in Tennessee, and then I had already gone and seen it with a friend. The theater was totally silent. You know how sometimes when you go to a movie, you can hear people talking or whatever? The theater was totally silent. And when the movie was finished, there was just like this holy hush. And everyone was walking out of the theater just thinking, contemplating, looking at your own life and saying, what am I willing to give up? What am I willing? You know, I mean, a few of the scenes just, you know, will stay with me forever. Paul was talking, now obviously they took some license to be able to make a story out of this, but Paul was talking to some of the Christians that had been imprisoned, and they were going to have what was called Nero's Circus the following day, which meant that they were going to go into the arena with the lions. And there was women, and there was children, and there was men, and they were afraid. And Paul stood up, and he looked at him, and he said, it'll only hurt for a moment. It'll only hurt for a moment. Can you imagine? And at the very end of the film, when historically, there's not a scripture verse, but historically, it is said that Paul was beheaded. At the very end, when he is beheaded, there's a scene of all the people that he had persecuted in his life as Saul before his conversion, waiting to welcome him. Wow. Little girl ran up and pulled her, hugged him. People that he had sentenced to death for their faith. It's an impactful movie. I would highly suggest that you get it or get it on video when it comes out to be able to watch it. But it has a real message, because that's what Christianity is all about. It's not about just coming and, you know, singing some songs on Sunday and going out and living your life. It's like there could come a time in your life where there is some real opposition, some real persecution. And how will you stand up to that? How much does your faith mean to you? What are you willing to give to stand up for that faith? To not compromise? And I'll tell you, I've just seen God do some amazing things. When we're just willing to keep moving forward. You know, sometimes it's just a baby step. Sometimes, you know, you don't know what the future holds, and it can be fearful, but just take another step.
Amen.
Just take another step, and you'll be amazed at what God can do and how your life can truly count for something. I would not be doing anything other than what I'm doing. I love what I'm doing. I get tired. I said to my son a couple days ago, I said, you know, these trips don't get any easier every year. You know, the traveling back and forth, you know, on this particular trip, I'm in 7 states and I was also in Cuba. But I love what I'm doing. I have a passion for it. And I thank God that He's allowed me this opportunity to be able to do what I do. You know, there's people that go to work every day just because they have to. Just because at the end of the week, they need a paycheck. They need to buy groceries. They need to, you know, pay the rent. But they don't get any real satisfaction or feeling of, you know, that their life is making a difference or feeling good about what they do. And I thank God that I have that. I know that, you know, my willingness to serve God can make a difference. And your willingness to serve God can make a difference. Don't get hung up on different other things, on, you know, well, you know, my job this or whatever. You know, be open to allow God to be able to use you every single day. Amen. There's opportunities. There's people that will cross your path. There's people that just need a word of encouragement. There's people that need that phone call to know that you care. I've been told 2 testimonies, and one of them was told out in your parking lot, so I won't go into details, but 2 different testimonies that I've heard on this trip about, you know, people that outwardly had it all together, but that their life ended tragically. Sometimes you don't know what's going on inside people's hearts. Sometimes, you know, we have a tendency as Christians to wear the mask and to smile. How are you? Oh, I'm fine. When inside you can be tore up and you can be hurting. As Christians, if we allow the Holy Spirit to lead us and guide us every day of our life, He's going to direct you to that person that needs that encouragement, that needs that hug, that needs to be told that you were thinking of them, that needs you to reach out in some way. You'll never know what that can mean to someone at the right time. Amen. So I want to encourage you with that. I have a 4-minute video that is an update of some of what we do. I'll put that on and then I'll share a little bit with you after that, but it'll give you an idea of what we do down in Guatemala with Servant Ministries. It is a multifaceted ministry, and so we're involved in a lot of different areas. And so we'll put that on and then I'll share in greater detail with you. Are we ready? Is it good? Okay. Areas that we're involved in. I want to put a plug in here for teams. I know, you know, Haley has been down before. Tell her I'd love to see her come back down again. James Turner, who I understand some of you may know, is bringing a team this November, and it's going to be a BBS team, and he has about 5 or 6 right now that he has on board, but he needs to add to that, and I've got some people from Michigan that might be joining the team too, but and I'm sure that he would enjoy having a couple adults come along, you know, to be able to help with the team. But if you know of young people that would like to be able to go on a trip, these trips can absolutely transform their lives. I hear testimonies all the time about, you know, a young person came down on a medical team, and as a result of that, now they, you know, are studying to be a doctor or became a nurse or you know, we're touched and are today are a youth pastor as a result of coming down on a short-term mission trip. You know, we've opened it up to be able to do internships for longer-term things. Retirees to be able to come down and do an alternative to snowbirds, to be able to come down and spend a couple of months and just, you know, get involved as you're able to and to be able to see something and to feel that you're contributing towards something that is making a difference in people's lives. You know, if you know of anyone that has a heart, that has said, I really would like to go on a mission trip, but I don't know how to connect with anyone, you know, please get them in touch with me. It truly can transform your their lives. The school sponsorship program was actually one that Verl came down to participate with this year. We covered almost 6,200 children. This outreach, I know some of you have probably heard this story, but I think there's some new people here. This outreach started because a teacher came to my gate and told me that all that her students had to do their work was sewing needles and they were scratching their letters on rocks. And she said, you know, I have to send in a report to the government, a progress report to show that they're where they're supposed to be. And she said, I can't, you know, totally serious, I can't send in boxes of rocks. And she said, could you please buy us paper and pencils? And, you know, I had been in the mission field a number of years at this point, and that really impacted me. I thought, wow, you know, in the 21st century that there's still, you know, that kind of thing going on. So we started reaching out to the schools. I think when we started with 1,400 kids, and now we're up to almost 6,200. And we've got about another 40 schools on a waiting list that would love us to take them into account. One of the things we did in the earlier days, we tried to give some classroom resources to the teachers because they get so little to work with. And one year I bought pencil sharpeners, the wall-mounted kind that you put on a wall. And I had to actually show the teachers, you know, those of us who are older that remember, you know, you crank the handle and and sharpen the pencils. And after we had done a number of them, I said, okay, now you have to twist this canister to dump out the pencil shavings. And I'll never forget one of the first teachers said, well, I would never do that. And I said, well, you know, what do you mean? It's going to get full. You have to empty it out. And she said, no, I'll empty it out, but I would never throw that away. She said, that'll be the prize for the best behaved student that day. Would you like to take home some pencil shavings? She said, they can start a fire for their dinner, to be able to cook their dinner. You know, puts things on another whole level. You know, these kids aren't getting any electronics, they're not getting anything fancy, they're getting just lined notebooks and pencils, and the most luxurious thing we put in there is either some wax, some regular crayons or some colored pencils. But you know, they're encouraged. And they're waiting for it. And they'll have presentations, they'll have little programs ready to do for us because they are so thankful that we're coming to be able to hand out these school packs. And so Verl was part of that. He got lots and lots of pictures of the kids from the mountains. Sometimes, you know, we had to just meet them on the highway, on the dirt roads, because we couldn't get down, even with four-wheel drive vehicles, we couldn't get down to the actual school. And so you just kind of handed them out from the back end of a pickup, and you know, but you're making a difference. These kids, it's the first generation that is breaking the cycle of illiteracy. Their parents never got a chance to go to school. Their grandparents never had a chance to go to school. And so it's making a difference. And you know, I'm looking for people that have a heart for that kind of thing. You know, I mean, whether it's a school, a class, a church, you know, an individual or whatever, but education is important. It's something that's going to help these kids to take a step forward and have a better life than what their parents do. And you know, the really neat thing about it is it's not just about handing out school supplies. We have a relationship with these schools. When I have teams come in, you know, we'll go up to a school and they'll have time to interact with the kids, and they can go out in the playground and play with them and jump rope and play hopscotch or soccer or whatever. But in the classroom, we can read Christian stories to them. We can talk about the gospel. We have that freedom to be able to do that, thank God, in Guatemala. And so we're able to also go back and have a relationship and sow some spiritual seeds into these children's lives. I've taken medical teams up to some of our schools. you know, these people never see doctors, and it's the only medical care they get. I have medical teams that come down every year, and it's the only medical care that these people get, is when, you know, these teams come in. And so it can really make a difference, really impact them. The Embrace program, we started in 2000. It makes a tremendous difference in a child's life. I want to thank this congregation again for the little girl that, as a church, as a whole, that you are sponsoring. You know, she went home with one of everything at Christmas time. And one of the things, one of the biggest item that we offered at Christmas this last year was to be able to have an eco stove, which uses 2/3 less firewood, and it eliminates all the smoke. These women have worked their entire lives inside a very smoky kitchen, making their tortillas 3 times a day, which is generally the only thing that they're eating is tortillas and salt. And they're breathing that in. And you know, I knew that, but you know what I hadn't thought about? Where are the young children? They're with mama. They're with mama. And so from the time that these children are very, very young, they're in this environment where they're breathing in all this smoke. And we see so many kids, especially with respiratory problems. And this is a big part of it. And Wendy's family doesn't have to worry about that anymore, thanks to this church. So thank you. You're actually going to be receiving something just within the next couple of weeks that we're going to do a mid-year outreach. And we're going to try to make sure that every Embrace child has a good pair of shoes. Because some of these kids walk for hours to come to the monthly meetings. And most of the little girls have flip-flops or the little jelly shoes. And it's not because that's what they really want to wear. It's just that that's all they can afford. And so, I mean, the boys wear these rubber boots with no socks. And so it promotes foot fungus and things like this. So I'm going to be putting a promotion out to our sponsors to not only help their own children, but to help other children who may not have a sponsor yet, or maybe their sponsor is not going to participate in this, but to make sure that every child in Embrace has a good pair of shoes. You know, I don't spend a lot of money on clothes. People, you know, of course, I haven't lived in the country in almost three decades. You know, someone will say a name brand, and I said, sorry, doesn't mean anything to me, you know. And so name brands don't really impress me too much. You know, my extent of shopping is usually Walmart, Dress Barn, and Bonworth at the outlet malls. And so, but I'll tell you one thing I am willing to spend a little bit more on are shoes. I've got a plate and 5 pins in one ankle. And I just came from California, from being at my son's. And my daughter-in-law is Korean, and so they have the tradition of not wearing shoes in their house. And so I try to respect that, you know, respect my daughter-in-law. But I'll tell you, by the end of the week, I'm hobbling. I'm limping. Because if I don't have a good shoe on, I can't walk well. And by the end of the week, you know, it's like my son said something. He said, Mom, you're not walking right. I said, yes. If I could put my shoes on, I would walk better. But a good pair of shoes can make all the difference. And so I want to make sure that the Embrace kids get some good shoes. So that's going to be one of our upcoming outreaches. We have 2 churches that all of a sudden they're not big enough. Good problem to have. I mean, you know, I mean, I go into a lot of churches, and I can't say that there's any church that I have gone into where there's not some vacant seats or pews. And so, you know, we have 2 churches that have outgrown their facility. Praise God. Amen. But we're going to have to figure out a way how to build them a bigger building. We have to build a new church this year, and this is a cool story. One of our original churches that we built, like in 1991, we hadn't started servant ministries yet. We were working with a local denomination from Guatemala. We built this church, when we started our own entity, some of our earlier churches stayed underneath the covering, you know, the spiritual covering that they had. So this was one of those churches. So we kind of lost touch with them. Well, this church, when we started, we had a lot of opposition. There was a witch doctor in this village that just really came against me. And, you know, he would tell me, you know, I've been successful all these years to keep the Christians out of here until you came. Thank you. And he put his little finger in my face and said, I'm praying curses on you. Well, greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. There was a lot of opposition. So like I said, we kind of lost touch with, you know, with this church. So recently some situations have arisen just, you know, within the month or two before I left. And the doors have opened for us to go back into this village. And there were some problems in the church, you know, welcome to the world. But, you know, there were some problems in the churches and some splits and whatnot. And anyway, there is a group of Christians that are holding home meetings, but, you know, would like to have a spiritual covering over them. One of those women is one of the very first believers that we raised up back in 1991. Today she is 78 years old. But she's still serving God. Her children are in the church leading praise and worship. Her grandchildren are in the church leading praise and worship. And she has great grandbabies that are still real little, but they're being brought to church. So it was so cool to see. We don't always see that rippling effect. You know, you don't always see, you know, what's going to happen from something that you do today. What's the future of that? And it was so neat. I said, God, thank you for letting me see this. You know, that 25 years later, that we've got three more generations that have been raised up in the church. And you know what the coolest part of it is? The pastor, the man that we've put in as pastor to be able to oversee this group, his wife is the granddaughter of the witch doctor. Oh, thank you, Jesus. So that was really cool too. So God's doing some amazing stuff. Something new that has opened up just in the last year, and it really made me nervous. It's like, okay, Lord, you know, I want to be willing to do whatever, you know, you're putting before me, but are you sure this is of you? There's a surgeon, an orthopedic surgeon from Tennessee that has come down on medical outreaches before, but when we go out, you're dealing with day-to-day stuff. You know, you're handing out worm pills, you're handing out vitamins, you're handing out cough syrup, you know, and simple stuff. And obviously, I understand that a surgeon is going to get more gratification from using his specialty, his field, than just, you know, doling out vitamins. And so he says, Nancy, can I come down and do surgeries in Guatemala? I said, really? And, you know, my head's going on. I thought, oh my gosh, the liability of this. you know, it's a lot different to hand out vitamins than it is to open someone up and start revamping stuff. And so I actually found an orthopedic surgeon who I have known and we have used in the past with some of our Embrace children, and went to him and I said, what do you think? He said, I love the idea. And he says, I'm in the process of building a small hospital, just like a 7-bed hospital, be a private hospital. And he said, what I have in my heart is to be able to use it for people that can't afford to go to other hospitals to have their surgery done. And so he said, if you can bring this surgeon in, you know, I will, once the hospital is finished, I will let them use the hospital at no charge and allow these people to be able to find the help that they need. Well, we have found some incredible cases. He came down for the first time January of this year. A missionary friend that I've been friends with for many, many years, lives in the area. She needed a knee replacement. He gave her a knee replacement. Someone that, another missionary, one of their workers was in an accident while he was there, broke his collarbone. He did that surgery. One of my workers, his brother was run over by a car, and he had been in the government hospital for 6 weeks, and it's social medicine there. I mean, they'll give you a bed in the hospital, but you might just lay there and not have anything done for you. And so they had done a surgery on his back and another surgery, but he had a multiple fracture in his one leg and was waiting because someone needed to buy the pins and whatever he needed. And he had been in the hospital for 6 weeks, not in traction. Well, you know, I'm not medical, so someone had to explain this with me, but that doesn't work too well. So in that 6 weeks, his injured leg shrunk up almost 6 inches shorter than the other leg and had started to, you know, reconnect badly, you know, which was not going to be a good scenario. So this orthopedic surgeon, the Guatemalan one, you know, told me that he would like to be able to help, and I said, you know, he doesn't have the money to be transferred into a private hospital. He doesn't have the money. The orthopedic surgeon paid to have him put into a private hospital, and they did the surgery. And here in the United States, the surgeon from Tennessee explained to me, you know, everything's done on video today. So you're doing surgery, and you've got this camera and screen over here, and you know exactly what's going on, and so you can, you know, work with that. So if you need to, like, say, bring out one leg, there's equipment to be able to help you to do that, you know, all through yeah, machines. And down there, you take the leg, and you just heave it. And so they got it within 1 centimeter.
Wow.
From 6 inches down to 1 centimeter, they got it that close. There was a little boy that when he was 5 years old, he grabbed on to a live wire and he was being electrocuted. And his father, trying to save him, grabbed on to the little boy, it passed through to the father, and the father was killed. The little boy lost both of his legs and one arm. One leg below the knee, one leg above the knee, and one complete arm. You know, we had all these cases that were sent to me prior to the surgeon arriving down in Guatemala. The day after he arrived, we went after church, and from 2 to 10 o'clock in the afternoon on Sunday, there was this entire bulging, overflowing room of 30-some patients that the doctor down there had found, and that they went through case by case with the surgeon from Tennessee. This young man that had lost both of his legs is 11 years old today. And he walked in, and you would have never known. He had 2 prostheses, and for his legs, he still doesn't have his arm, but they're going to be doing surgery in May to be able to help him to be ready to get a prosthesis for his arm. You know, a little boy named Josue, that his legs are just twisted and bent, and he was born that way, and he's never, you know, would never have any kind of a normal life, and he's about 6 years old. And the doctor from Tennessee has found people here in the United States to donate pediatric rods that can be put into his legs. And so they're going to actually be arriving back the same day that I do from this trip. And in May, they're going to do one side, both the upper and the lower leg, with these pediatric rods. He's going to come back again in January, and they'll do the other side. And, you know, that will absolutely transform that child's life. You know, give him a life, let's say. And so, you know, it was a scary step to be able to take that step forward, but I can see what God is doing and the potential that is there and how, you know, we can make a difference. There's children, I can't tell you the medical term, but there's some kind of condition that their bones are just very, very brittle and soft, and they break without falling or being injured. They just break. And there was a little 2-year-old that they brought in that she was just getting old enough to walk, 9 months old. She was just starting to pull herself up and learn how to walk, and she fractured her leg for the first time. At less than 2 years old, she's already had 3 fractures. So she's never got to the point that she can walk, because every time she gets big enough, you know, she gets another fracture. And so they're going to put rods in her legs in May. And again, make a difference in that child's life. The hospital isn't finished yet, but it's supposed to be finished very, very soon. The orthopedic surgeon from Tennessee, he has a friend that is a plastic surgeon, and he said he would like to come down and do the cleft lips and palates, and wanted to know, is that something that we could arrange? So again, we're going to have to find like the counterpart in Guatemala to be able to do that, but now I can see what could happen in this. The orthopedic surgeon is offering his facility to be used for whatever kind of surgeries we want to use it in. He wants them to bring down a complete surgical team. If you know of someone that's medical and that would like to do something like this, he would like an anesthesiologist to come down with them. He would like a nurse, you know, that could come down and give the post-op care. You know, and actually bring in, because this hospital, this is what it's going to be used for. It's not going to be staffed on a regular basis. It's only going to be used when teams such as what we're planning, you know, come in and do something like that. The cleft lips is exciting to me because I got thinking, I see a lot of children in Guatemala. You know, we reach out with the school thing to over 6,000 kids, you know, all my kids in Embrace, all the kids that we see wherever we go. I don't remember seeing small children with the cleft lips. And I got thinking, there's a reason for that. If they're born that way and they don't get the help, they die. Because they can't nurse, because they can't latch on to their mom. And going out and buying formula isn't an option, you know, for these people, and so they die. And my secretary told me that we are currently in our medical clinic, we have a milk program, and we have a couple babies right now that have cleft lips. And so if we can find them when they're little and maintain them on milk until we're able to be able to get the surgery done for them, you've just given the child back his life. And you know, this orthopedic surgeon that we're friends with, he's a believer, he's a Christian. And so, you know, we have a free open door, you know, to be able to talk to people. But why do we do this? What is our motivation? What is our reason for doing this? And so, you know, there's opportunities. God just seems to be enlarging my tent stakes. And I said, Lord, you know, I mean, I'm to a point that I, you know, need to have some more people come on board and be thinking about some succession at some point. But new doors are opening. And I don't want to lose those opportunities. I went to Cuba last year for the first time because a friend of mine, Cuba opened up to U.S. cruise ships 2 years ago this summer. And my friend, her name is Nancy as well, her and her husband went, and they were on the third cruise ship that was allowed to go to Cuba. And my friend goes to a Nazarene church. She's spirit-filled. She goes to a Nazarene church. And she said a simple prayer before she left on this cruise. She said, Lord, give me a Cuban pastor to bless. Amen. And again, I want to just try to show you how such a simple prayer that you can pray, how it can grow, the rippling effect, what can come out of it. She said that simple prayer. Well, she went on the cruise. Not only did God bring her a pastor, he brought her a Nazarene pastor. Amen. And as a result, you know, she blessed him, I don't know, in whatever way. She got back home, and her pastor kind of calls them in. He kind of looks at them as mentors. And so he called them in. They pray together once a week. And the next time they went in to pray, the pastor said, you know, God's been putting Cuba on my heart. And, you know, I would really like to have that be our mission focus for the next couple of years. But how in the world would we ever contact a Cuban pastor? And they said, well, we just happen to know how that could be done. And as a result of that, both the husband and wife have gone down, sometimes together, sometimes individually. They have each gone to Cuba probably 5 or 6 times. Their church has sent down multiple mission groups. Nancy asked me last year, she said, would you like to go to Cuba? I said, sure. And I said, but I already have my dates planned, so the only thing I can do is, you know, use the weekend that I was going to be, you know, in town with your church. And she said, okay. And so we went, and she said, now, Nancy, I don't have anything planned. I got someone picking us up from the airport, dropping us off at a bread and breakfast, picking us up 2 days later, and taking us back to the airport. That's all that's arranged. You know, whatever God wants to do, he can do. And so we flew Southwest to Cuba, which, you know, is the only airline that I know of that still allows you to have 2 50-pound bags and not charge you anything. And so we had a direct flight from Tampa, and we were loaded down with all of our stuff. And my book has been translated into Spanish, and if for no other reason, it was good that I translated my book into Spanish, because Cuba loves my book. They love my book. So our driver that picked us up, we gave him all of our goodies and said, here, this is to share with whoever. We had some daily breads in Spanish and my books and some Christian music. And you're not allowed to do anything formally in the church if you don't go in on a religious visa, which we did not have. But I was allowed to bring in my books. I couldn't bring in any other Christian book, but I could bring in my book because I'm the author. And so we said, well, we'd like to go to church tomorrow. And so he said, okay, I'll pick you up. And the next day he picked us up, and people started walking up to me, and they said, oh, you're the author of that book. I'm reading it, you know? It's really, really good. I mean, this is less than 24 hours I've been into Cuba, and my books have already been handed out. Anyway, long and short of it, incredible doors opened up. They invited me to come back to be able to do a big women's meeting, which I just did about 3 weeks ago as soon as I got back into the States. Incredible meeting. Boy, you want to talk about some women that know how to intercede, that know how to get it done when it comes to praying. And some of you know the story about, you know, how I was accused of murdering a little girl. And basically, the case has never been closed. This has been 10 years ago. The case has never been closed. My name has never been cleared. They say they know who was really involved, but the police are afraid of them and are not going to go after them. So that's the way it stood. Well, one woman in Cuba come up and says, no, no, that's not right. That's not right. Your name needs to be cleared. So they talked to the leaders. They got this 200-plus women praying, you know, that God is going to, you know, bring to light that which was done in darkness, is going to bring the guilty people to justice, and is going to clear my name. And you want to talk about women interceding, I mean crying. And I said, thank you so much. You have no idea what this means to me. And I will certainly let you know when this happens, when God does something. And they said, no. You will come to Cuba and you will tell us in person. I said, you got it. You got it. But they've already invited me back. I have an open door to go back whenever I want. So it's just amazing. And it all started with a woman saying, give me a pastor that I can bless. And less than 2 years out, all of this has happened. And who knows how much further that's going to go. So I say that as an encouragement to you. You know, your prayers, something you do today that might seem very insignificant, can have such far-reaching effects. So just keep moving forward. Come see me at the table in the back. I've brought a number of things that I need to get out of my suitcase. I'm going from flight to flight to flight. I had a very gracious person that waited on me from American Virgin that did not complain that my suitcase was 6 pounds overweight, and she let me through, but she says, not everyone's gonna do this. And so I need to sell that stuff so that I get to go and do some shopping and take some stuff back to Guatemala with me. So I've got some wonderful Guatemalan coffee. I've got some of the typical items that they make. I have 16 Embrace children that need a sponsor. You know, if you have ever considered doing child sponsorship and would like to do that on your own, individually, beyond what the church is doing for the one that you do corporately, I have some children back there that you can look at their files, at their pictures, and make a decision to be able to make a difference in their lives. I do have a card swiper. If you don't have the cash, you can write a check as well. Thank you for the opportunity to be able to come and share with you, to kind of give you an update. And I just want you to know that, you know, when you exit those doors today, there's a lot of opportunities waiting for you. Mm-hmm. Just keep your eyes open, keep your spirit alert. Holy Spirit can nudge you at just the right time and give you just the right words that can be life-changing for someone. And you know, there's nothing greater in this world than allowing yourself to be used by God. There's nothing greater. Nothing greater in this world. Nothing feels better than just, you know, saying, yes, Lord, I'm willing to do that. He isn't looking for ability. He can give you the ability. He's looking for availability. Absolutely. He's looking for someone that's willing to say, here I am, Lord. Send me. Thank you. God bless you.